Hi, I'm Andrew from Creative Guitar, and there was a question that was sent into the studio over the weekend by Martin, and he's asking here, what is relative pitch? Is it the same or different than perfect pitch? Also, which one is best to learn as a guitarist, and can you give me any tips for practicing ear training techniques overall? So that's going to be our topic for today. We're going to take a look at the whole world of relative pitch, the building blocks of it, clear up the misconceptions perhaps some people might have with perfect pitch. And maybe we'll just actually start with that. We'll just clear that perfect pitch concept up real quick. By the way, perfect pitch and relative pitch, they're two different things. They can be used very effectively hand in hand, but they're definitely two different things. Let's talk about perfect pitch for just a moment. Perfect pitch is the skill that's usually quite natural for the people that do have it, where they develop it quite early in terms of an association between the sound heard and a specific note that would be something played on a musical instrument. So for example, if someone with perfect pitch had their back turned to me, they had no idea, maybe they didn't even have an idea of the notes on the guitar, maybe they played piano or something else, and I played them a C note, they would be able to tell, with their back turned to me, that that was a C note. Now, musicians, as they go on in their career, they do develop this slowly but surely. You're able to tell the differences between tones, as you go on. But some people have the skill very, very well developed at a very early age. It's just quite natural to them. So that's what perfect pitch is. You may be able to hear a tone of some kind and then know that it's a C or an F sharp or a B flat or whatever. So that's perfect pitch. Now, going to the world of relative pitch, which is more of the skill sets that are taught in your typical ear training classes in college or university, music school settings, is what's really the difference. You want to understand the difference in the intervalic idea of one note going to another note. So let's say we had a C, but it was going to be traveling to an E, and it was E natural, so that's a major third. So being able to understand what that sound is just by hearing it while you have no instrument in your hands, that's the development of relative pitch. So it's really being able to tell the intervalic distance from one note to another, which you could imagine would just obviously expand out to the whole world of understanding the sounds of chords, which is one of the biggest benefits of having a good handle with relative pitch, is you can hear a chord and you can go, oh, that's a major, or that's a major seventh, or that's a diminished chord, or that's augmented, or that chord there happens to be a dominant seventh. So that's where the real benefit comes from understanding how to develop relative pitch and working on that and developing it to a very good level. So let's talk about that. Let's get into a discussion here about how to develop relative pitch. Next, let's go to the whole world of how to practice intervals and all the associated ideas that you need to have with ear training. Of course, intervals are a massive part of this. That's what we're going to be starting off with. We're going to take a major scale, just a basic G major scale off the third fret. And what we're going to do with it is every step of it, we're going to associate a song to it to help build your recall skills for that particular interval. Let me show you what I mean by that. We're going to go from a G to an A. It's a major second. And the associated melody we're going to put to help you remember this interval is going to be Happy Birthday to You. Because the very first motion in Happy Birthday is basically a major second. If we move to the next interval in the major scale, it's a major third. Now you recognize that melody? You're right, it's Oh When the Saints. Now that's going to be our major third association. Let's go to the next note in the scale. It's a perfect fourth interval to a C note, and we're going to use the bridal chorus for that one. I'm sure you've heard that if you've ever been to a wedding. Now let's go to the fifth interval. For that one, we're going to use the Star Wars theme from the old classic 77 movie there, Star Wars. Okay, so that'll be our association for a perfect fifth. Now we're going to go to a major sixth. In a major sixth, for that one, we're going to use the old melody for My Bonnie Lies Over the Ocean. So I'm sure you've heard of that. If you haven't, some of these you may not have heard of at all. It may not work for you whatsoever. So that means you're going to possibly have to go maybe even do a couple of Google searches on ear training yourself for relative pitch training and associated melodies for it. And I'm sure there's some websites. I know in the past I have seen some that give some associated melodies. You'll need to find a song though. to help you remember the relationship of you know, what intervals sound like to a piece, to build a recall skill so you'll know that it's a major six or a perfect fifth or whatever. Now, when we move along here to the major seven, that's a tough one because it's a leading tone and it wants to sort of pull you to that octave. It's a very dissonant interval. So there's not really a song that I can associate quickly and easily for that one. I don't know if I ever really have. I've always just thought about that interval as a pulling sound to resolve to the octave. Right? And for an octave, though, it's very easy. It's that old classic, Somewhere Over the Rainbow. I'm sure you've heard that before, too. So there you go. We just completed G major scale. We've done every step. We've got a song or a melody associated with every step except for that major seventh, which we were just talking about using it as the sound of a leading tone to resolve. The pull is what we're kind of after, you know, recalling in our mind to resolve it to the octave. So that's major, at least anyway. Let's go to the world of minor quickly and cover those tones. The first one we're going to go into is the minor second. And you might have noticed there, that's the old theme from the old Jaws movie. I think it's from, again, from the 70s. The Jaws theme from that movie. Basically, that's your minor second interval. If we go to minor third, that's the lullaby. I'm sure you've heard that before. If we go to the next interval, which would be a diminished fifth, and I'm skipping around because we've already covered a lot of the other ones with, you know, the work that we did on the major scale. So diminished fifth, that to me, I always associated that one to the Simpsons television theme, you know. You'll remember that TV show. So that's just the very first interval there. It's just a Simpsons show. And then the next one after that is going to be the minor seventh. And for me, the one I've always used is the old Ford commercials where they'd say, "Have you driven a Ford lately?" You may have heard that one if you're familiar with North American television of the probably 1980s and early 90s era. So that basically covers all of them now for minor. We've got a song association for pretty much every one of them, and that's kind of your first step. That's what you have to do to be able to get this stuff down, because you have to have that recall skill, and that recall ability is only developed through a lot of constant work, and, you know, through associating the sounds to some popular melodies that are out there. You may want to also make yourself an ear training, audio recording that you can go to, maybe record about 30 or 40 different intervals, have them sort of on an answer sheet for yourself, and then go back every few days and test yourself on it, try to recall, you know, or get the correct recall of the interval that you're listening to. You can do it with friends, you know, other musicians that you're training with, get them to play you a few intervals, and also, you know, there's websites too. There's a website, I think it's called Tiora.com, and you can just use their ear training programs that are sort of, I think they're sort of like a flash-based type of ear training system that they have online. It's all very good. So anyway, that's basically what you want to start with. I'll definitely do some more of these ear training videos. I think they're extremely valuable to have some skills down to help yourself to get to the point, at least anyway, where when you hear most things, like whether you're hearing a major chord or a dominant seventh chord or diminished sounds, that you basically know what you're listening to. That's the whole point of it, is that when you hear something, you know, there's some clarity in your mind of what you can make a judgment call in terms of what specifically you're hearing or listening to. So hopefully that's cool with everybody, and thanks a lot for the question, Martin. Appreciate all the questions that get sent in. And until then, you know, until we meet up next time, I will just, tell you to keep practicing this stuff. It's not easy, but through a lot of diligent work, you do get your chops up with it. So keep jamming out on this stuff, keep practicing, and until next time, take care.